Sunday. Let's turn in our hymnal to 252.50. He keeps me singing. Let's all stand together once you find that. There's within my heart a melody on that first. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still in a loveless heaven flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing. Hears me singing as I go. On that third, feasting on the riches of his grace, resting neath a sheltering wing, always looking on his smiling face. That is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. On the last, soon he's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall ring with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
All right, good singing. Good to see everybody here today. Looking forward to a wonderful service together. And thanks for making the effort and being in church this morning. Let's open with prayer together, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you for another Lord's Day that you brought us to. We're thankful for another opportunity to gather together here with God's people, to sing the songs of God and to fellowship one with another. And then, Lord, to open up your word and learn and to hear what the Spirit would say to each one of us this morning. Father, these folks have made the effort to be here and they want to hear from you this morning. And so, God, I would ask you to minister to the hearts of every person here this morning. Please meet with us. Give us what each of us individually needs today, as only you can do. And we'll give you the praise and the glory for decisions that are made today. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
268 in your hymnal, 268. Would you turn with me, please? I will sing of my Redeemer. On that first together, 268. I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross he suffered, from the curse to set me free. Sing a song of my Redeemer. With his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon. He paid the debt and made me free. I will tell the wondrous story, how my lost estate to save. In the boundless love of mercy, he the ransom freely gave. Sing, oh sing, of my Redeemer. With his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon. He paid the debt and made me free. On that last together, I will sing of my Redeemer and his heavenly love to me. He from death to life hath brought me, Son of God with him to be. Sing, oh sing, of my Redeemer. With his blood he purchased me. On that cross he sealed my pardon. He paid the debt.
Well, we have a few announcements now. Listen carefully, if you would. Our schedule today, as usual, 5:30 for our Christian growth class, and we meet down in the conference room right across from our nursery. And tonight we'll be teaching about the church and helping you understand what the church is and what church is all about, and what the Bible says about the importance of church. And so that'll be our 5:30 class tonight for Christian growth. And 6:30 back here in the auditorium for our evening service. And don't miss tonight. I want to bring a message about perceptions. And it'll be, I guarantee you, it'll help you. And it'll you'll be able to use it to help somebody else. But all of us can fall victim to our perceptions and can hurt us. And so don't miss tonight. It'll be a great, great time together. Then remember, ladies, your night out is tomorrow night, 6:30. You can still sign up for that downstairs on the table. And you meet in the fellowship hall 6:30 tomorrow night. It's just $4 a person. Looks like you're having soup and subs and salad and Ann Moreland. And Ann Moreland's going to be speaking tomorrow evening at that meeting. And there'll be some other fun things you're going to be doing and learning. So, ladies, you look forward to that tomorrow night, 6:30. Then don't forget, Tuesday night begins the Grove City School of the Bible, 7 o'clock. That also is in the Fellowship Hall. Those of you who signed up for those classes, just don't forget that. That begins this Tuesday evening. And then, ladies, your ladies' retreat is coming up in Mansfield that we go to every year. Well, we don't go to it, but you do. And it is bloom is what it looks like. And you're going to bloom. I always like to say bloom where you're planted, amen? But it's just a bloom here and some pretty flowers. It is March 10th and 11th. And it's $35 for adults. It's $20 for teenagers. Never have figured that out, why they teenagers eat more than adults. Why do they always give them half price? You know what I mean? And how many understand that? I don't understand that. And but they give a break to teenagers, $20. There's a sign-up sheet available down on the table in the foyer as well. So, ladies, you can get your name on that. And if you need more information, and you can see Lindy McKeon, and she'll give you what you need to get signed up for that. All right, that's always a great time up in Mansfield, March 10th and 11th for our ladies' retreat. Okay? And remember your coin folders. If you need any coin folders, the ushers have those to continue to collect for the Bible Sunday. I Love My Bible Sunday, first Sunday of February. Those will be all that money collected goes to get the Bibles that Brother Yoder will have when he goes to India, and be given to the folks in India, to many, many of them, their first ever Bible of their own. And Lord willing, we'll have enough to get 500 Bibles. And we are doing it. Brother Nip and Lancaster Baptist Church down there in Lancaster, he is taking some, and they also are collecting money for this, and want to be a part of getting those Bibles to the folks in India. So it's an exciting time. So if you please don't hesitate to ask those guys for a coin folder. They can get them for you very quickly. And when you have those completed, you can just put them in the box up here. We collect those after every service, and we'll get the final tally in on the 5th of February. Okay? Now, let's take a moment. We'll welcome any guests we have with us today. We're always pleased when folks visit with us in the service. And if you're visiting today, just put your hand up in the air. We'd like to meet you and see who you are and where you're from right back here. A couple have been watching online, I believe. And tell us who you are and where you're from. Great. Dan and Karen from Grove City. Good to have you this morning. Thank you for coming and seeing us in person. Okay? All right. And right up here. Brad and Michelle. And? Aubrey. Okay. And another one in nursery. Good, good. Look at her, how alert she is. Yeah. She's more alert than half our members. And that's great. Amen. And great to have you visiting this morning. These folks know Steve and Cindy Richardson. And they encourage them to come visit with us this morning. So it's great to have you this morning. Thank you very much. Anybody else today for the very first time? Good. All right. Well, we'll take just a minute, if you would, and fill out the card the usher gave you. We appreciate you doing that. A little bit, we have the offering. Just place that card in the plate, if you would, so we'll have a record of your visit with us this morning. And keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. We're glad you're here this morning. Let's give them all a warm welcome, shall we?
Thank you.
Number 55, would you turn with me, please? Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? At the cross, at the cross. Number 55. On that first together. Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred hand for such a burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Children, you can be dismissed to junior church as we sing this last stanza together. Children, you are dismissed, but drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Amen. Great singing this morning. Would you turn with me to number 298? 298. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Stand with me if you would as we sing this first stanza together. Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever. From him no power of evil can sever. He gave his life to ransom my soul. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Jesus came down to bring me salvation, lifted me up from sorrow and shame. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. And greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Sing that chorus together. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. Let's sing that last all together. Joy floods my soul, for Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin that long had enslaved me. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. We'll sing that a cappella. On that last together, Joy floods my soul, for Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin that long had enslaved me. His precious blood he gave to redeem. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity.
Amen. Great singing. You be seated if you would. Ushers will come and receive our offering now this morning. Give as the Lord has blessed and prospered you through the week. And we'll have prayer and ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. Brother Pole, I'd like you to pray for us.
Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us to come into where we can worship you and learn more about you. And we pray that you'd be with the pastor, that you'd be with him and bless him with the message that he brings to us. And we pray that the offering that is taken up today, that it be that it would be pleasing to you. And we pray that you'd bless those that give and as well as those who cannot give. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Please take your Bible this morning to 2 Chronicles chapter 32. 2 Chronicles chapter 32, please, for our scripture reading this morning. We're going to read the first 8 verses of 2 Chronicles chapter 32. I'll begin on verse 1, then you join me on verse 2, then I'll read 3 together on 4, and we'll alternate like that, and then we'll end together on verse number 8. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture, please. All of us standing to read God's word. And I'll begin on verse 1. After these things and the establishment thereof, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came and entered into Judah and encamped against the fenced cities and thought to win them for himself. And when Hezekiah saw that Sennacherib was come, and he was purposed to fight against Jerusalem, he took counsel with his princes and his mighty men to stop the waters of the fountains, which were without the city, and they did help him. So there was gathered much people together, who stopped all the fountains and the brook that ran through the midst of the land, saying, "Why should the kings of Assyria come and find much water?" And he strengthened himself and built up all the wall that was broken, and raised it up to the towers, and another wall without, and repaired Millo in the city of David, and made darts and shields in abundance. And he set captains of war over the people, and gathered them together to him in the street of the gate of the city, and spake comfortably to them, saying, "Be strong and courageous. Be not afraid nor dismayed for the king of Assyria, nor for all the multitude that is with him. For there be more with us than with him. With him is an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles. And the people rested themselves upon the words of Hezekiah, king of Judah. And let's pray. Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this morning. Lord, I pray that you will prepare each of our hearts, that we'll be ready to receive the word from your precious word. Thank you for giving us the Bible today. Thank you, Lord, for preserving it. And I pray, Lord, that each of us would listen carefully today and not miss what you would want to say to each of us. I pray you'll use the special now to continue to make our hearts good soil that the Word of God can fall into and bring forth fruit in our lives. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Oh, I really wasn't one for going to church, you see. But I went that night somehow, in spite of that. They ushered me in with a warm and friendly smile, and 5 rows back I sat. 5 rows back, I remembered well the story of Jesus I heard them tell. They taught about heaven and one of hell. I listened from 5 rows back. The words of that preacher man were arrows of burning truth. They reached my heart as he spoke so earnestly. He told how Jesus suffered, how he bled and died, and he did it for sinners like me. Soon the choir was singing, just as I am. I knew I was lost, my life 'twas a sham. I came and I was washed in the blood of the Lamb. From 5 rows back, that night I came. Oh, what a change! Things are different now. Peace and happiness filled my heart. Jesus walks and talks with me each passing day. And I know that through the years of time and through eternity, I'll not forget that night. All my sins were washed away. Oh, the choir was singing, just as I am. I knew I was lost, my life, it was a sham. I came and I was washed in the blood of the Lamb. From 5 rows back, that night I came. Oh yes, from 5 rows back, that night I came.
That's good. Now, Father in heaven, we bow before you in prayer, and Lord, we thank you for the great salvation that we have through Jesus Christ. Lord, I'm asking you now for help as we come to open up your word this morning. Thank you for the good music today. Thank you, Lord, for it's just been good to be in the house of the Lord today with the people of God. Thank you for the good spirit that's in this place today. Lord, we're asking now that you would control the next few moments, that we open up your precious word, and that Spirit of God, you would speak to hearts this morning as only you can. Please give me your help. as we bring this message today, and please help the people as they listen. And may we understand the truth that you have for us today. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Have your Bible open to 2 Chronicles chapter 32. I'm going to tell you the story here a little bit of what is taking place. It's about 705 B.C. and the king is Sennacherib. He's the king of Assyria. He has just taken over from his dad. And he's taken over a kingdom that, while it's vast, it's crumbling. There are starting to kind of fall apart on the outskirts. Some of the outlying areas that were part of the kingdom had begun to rebel. And so the first thing Sennacherib does is he builds up his army. And he builds up an army to about 200,000 troops that he's going to use to put down any rebellion in the kingdom. His kingdom would stretch over what we would know in the Bible as the land of the Philistines and the Phoenicians and the Babylonians and the Palestinians. It would cover parts of Saudi Arabia, northern Israel, Iran, Iraq. All of that would have been under the control of Sennacherib and the Assyrians. And he wasn't going to let any of that area go without a fight. He was going to do whatever he could to keep his kingdom and really to build his kingdom. The first victory, the first battle he fought was against the Babylonians, and he defeated them, destroyed Babylon, sacked the city, brought that nation back under the control of his government. He went westward from there and attacked Philistia and then Phoenicia and others in the Egyptian area, and he conquered them and brought them under his power again. And so they went one after another, and they won every single time. And they were bringing all these nations under his power, under his control. In fact, he made it no secret that he felt invincible, that no one could defeat him. In fact, he checked with his god, which was Asher. It's sometimes A-S-S-U-R, sometimes A-S-H-U-R. But he checked with them, with his god, and his god assured him that he would be victorious. And so he fought that way. And Assyria established its capital city under the name of that god, Asher. And later it was moved to another city that you're more familiar with called Nineveh. Now when you think about these conquering and what the Assyrians did, in fact, you'll find out that Sennacherib, after these battles and after these victories, there were stone carvings that were found years later. And there would be a picture of a king, which was him, and there would simply be heads of people stacked around him, showing that he didn't just win and he didn't just take the country back, but he beheaded those people and he kept their heads as souvenirs and he would stack them around him. They were vicious, vicious people. Sometimes he would impale people he conquered upon sharp poles and allow them to hang in the streets as examples of anybody who would go against him. So you understand, as he's defeating all these foes, he comes to Israel. And he is now threatening to take Israel. Now, wonder what these people think. Is this going to be the end of us? Like it's been the end of these other nations? What is going to happen? What is Hezekiah going to do? I love what verse chapter 32 says. Hezekiah tells the people this, verse 7. Be strong and courageous. Be not afraid nor dismayed for the king of Assyria, nor for all the multitude that is with him. For there be more with us than with him. And before they could start saying, well, he's got over 200,000 with him, what do we got? Before they could start doing the numbers calculations, he follows it up with verse 8 and says, with him is an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles. And then the people rested themselves upon the words of Hezekiah, the king of Judah. Sennacherib, he sent envoys, he sent messengers to try to discourage the people. In fact, He sent them to try to get them to surrender without a fight. Hold your finger there in Chronicles and turn to your left in your Bible to 2 Kings 19. 2 Kings 19, where this is told again with a little more detail in it. You get to see what Sennacherib sent to the people when Hezekiah had to tell him, be of good courage. There's more for us than with him, and he's got the arm of flesh, but we have the Lord our God. Notice in chapter 19 of 2 Kings, beginning in verse number 10, thus shall ye speak to Hezekiah, king of Judah, saying, let not thy God, in whom thou trustest, deceive thee, saying, Jerusalem shall not be delivered into the hand of the king of Assyria. Behold, thou hast heard what the kings of Assyria have done unto all lands by destroying them utterly. And shalt thou be delivered? Have the gods of the nations delivered them which my fathers have destroyed? Has Gozan and Haran and Rezeph and the children of Eden which were in Thelasar? Where is the king of Hamath and the king of Arpad and the king of the city of Sepharvaim? And Hena and Iva. And Hezekiah received the letter at the hand of the messengers and read it. And Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. Here's what he's saying. He sent the message in. He says, hey, you don't let your God deceive you. And by the way, can I tell you this? Your God, if your God is the God of the Bible, your God never deceives you. God is truth. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all, okay? So he said, don't let your God deceive you. Hey, we went into this country and their God couldn't save them. We took this country, their God couldn't save them. What happened to all those countries? What happened to all those gods? We burnt their gods up. Why do you think your God's going to deliver you? That's the message that they sent. That would be a little frightening to hear that message. You've already heard all the nations that have fallen before them. Now they're surrounding you. And you don't know what they're going to do. Hezekiah comes and he spreads out the letters before the Lord. And he prays to God, beginning in verse number 15. And as he prays and asks God to intervene and to hear the words of Sennacherib, which he'd sent, verse 16, to reproach the living God. And he says, of a truth, Lord, verse 17, the kings of Assyria have destroyed the nations and their lands. And yeah, they've cast their gods into the fire. But he says, Lord, they were no gods, but the work of men's hands, wooden stone. That's why they were destroyed. Now therefore, O Lord our God, I beseech thee, save thou us out of his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that thou art the Lord God, even thou only. Notice what Isaiah says. And God sends Isaiah, his prophet, the son of Amos, to Hezekiah, saying, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, that which thou hast prayed to me against Sennacherib, king of Assyria. Last three words. I have heard. I heard your prayer. I'm going to take care of it. All right? And by the way, God takes care of it. You find out. Look over and back to 2 Chronicles chapter 32, will you? 2 Chronicles chapter 32. They prayed, they cried unto God. That's all it says here in 2 Chronicles 32, verse 20. Look at verse 21. And the Lord sent an angel, which cut off all the mighty men of valor and the leaders and captains in the camp of the king of Assyria. So he returned with shame of face to his own land. And when he was come into the house of his God, they that came forth of his own bowels slew him there with the sword. Thus the Lord saved Hezekiah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem from the hand of Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, and from the hand of all other, and guided them on every side. God delivered him. Now, here's the whole key to what happened right there. All right, verse number 8. Hezekiah tells them, there's more for us. He tells them, they have the arm of flesh. We have the Lord our God to fight our battles. And the people rested themselves upon the words of Hezekiah, king of Judah. You know what they did? They rested on the words of the king. They rested on the words of the king. They relied on the words of the king. They put their faith in the words of the king. They trusted in the words of the king. They put their hope in the words of the king. And I want to serve record to you this morning. I'm resting on the words of the king. My hope is in the words of the king. I believe your satisfaction in life is how much you rest on the words of the king. I believe your happiness in life is going to be determined by how much you'll rest on the words of the king. Your success in life will be largely determined by how much you rest on the words of the king. Your accomplishments in life are going to be determined by how much you rest on the words of the king. If you're here this morning and you say, Pastor, you don't know what I'm facing. I've got some tremendous problems. I got some tremendous issues. My counsel to you would be rest on the words of the king. You may be here today and say, I've got some physical issues and I've got some things I'm dealing with physically and I don't know what the answer will be. Well, my friend, my counsel to you would be rest on the words of the king. Oh, but Pastor, I'm having trouble in my marriage and I don't know what's going to happen. Hey, rest on the words of the king. It doesn't matter your situation. It doesn't matter your difficulty. It doesn't matter the odds that are stacked against you. It doesn't matter how big the enemy seems. Rest on the words of the king. That's what our great need is. When you are discouraged, when you're in difficulty, when you're in trouble, if you are lonely, if you're longing for friendship, rest on the words of the king. You listen to me this morning. People change. Laws change. Places change. Colleges change. Preachers change. But the word of the king remains the same. The word of the king is always the same. Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. I am the Lord thy God, I change not. Truth never changes. And so you can get strength from his word. And the king spoke, and to the people's credit, they believed the king more than they believed the enemy. They knew what Sennacherib had done. They'd heard what he'd done. They knew what the odds were. And they said, we're going to believe what Hezekiah tells us. That God is for us and God will fight the battle. And you know what? The forces of Sennacherib were defeated and they didn't have to do anything. Oh, they made shields and they made the darts and they got all the ammunition ready. And they didn't have to use any of it. God sent an angel to the camp and the angel destroyed them. And he sent Sennacherib back home shamefaced. And when he got back home, his own family, his own son, those who came out of his own bowels came out and killed him. It's a sad thing, and it's a great victory that the Lord gave him that day. I'm telling you, the strength they got was in his words. The encouragement they got was in the words of the king. The energy they received were in the words of the king. I don't know your burdens today. I don't know your heartaches today. I don't know the load you carry. I don't know the battles you're fighting. I don't know the circumstances you're dealing with. But I know this morning. You must rest on the words of the king. You must rest on his words. To rest upon them, you must know them. To rest upon them, you must know them. And the only way to know them is to read them. The only way to know the words of the king and find comfort and find strength and find hope and find encouragement is you have to take the time to read the words of the king. You have to take time to listen to the words of the king. That means you got to turn the TV off and read the words of the king. It means you got to turn the computer off and turn the phone off and turn the iPod off and turn the iPad off and turn off all the other stuff and just listen to the words of the king. And take time to be encouraged and take time to hear what God wants to say to you. The Bible is not hard to understand. What's hard to understand is why God's people won't take time to read it. That's hard to understand. God gave us a book. We ought to know what he said. There's only one book in all the world that starts at the beginning. And you're holding it in your hand if you got a Bible in your hand this morning. And there's only one book that's going to take you all the way to the ending. And you're holding it in your hand. And it tells the beginning from the end and everything in between. And that is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending. And you've got the answer right here. Rely on the words of the King. Years ago, I remember visiting and knocked on a door and witnessed to a lady, Brother Chalkin. And I remember her looking at me and she's saying, well, you're basing everything you believe on that one book. And I said, yes, I am. Yes, I am. We're basing up. We're staking it all. We're staking it all on that book right there. That book is true. And this is God's Word. I'm relying, I'm resting on the words of the King. Now let me give you some practical thoughts this morning. I want you to rest on the words of the King for your provision. Your provision. Matthew 6 and verse 33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Jeremiah 33:3. Call unto me, and I'll answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things thou knowest not. Philippians 4:19. But my God shall supply all your need according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Psalm 37:4. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and He shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Do you rely on the words of the King for your provision? Rely on the words of the King to take care of you? Listen, rely on those words. Rest in those words. Trust in His Word. Trust on His promises. Standing on the promises of Christ my King. I want to stand on His promises. Elijah rested on those words and the ravens came and fed him. The widow woman relied and rested on those words, and that cruse of oil just kept pouring out day after day after day for a year. Israel rested on the words of the King and was fed with manna every morning. David rested on the words of the King and he slew the giant Goliath. The disciples rested on the words of the King and they saw Jesus feed over 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. They saw the provision of God. David said this in Psalm 37 and verse 25, I've been young and now I'm old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. I got news for you, single parent here this morning. Rest on the words of the King. I got news for you, young married couple struggling paycheck to paycheck or bill to bill. Rely on the words of the King. Rest on the words of the King for your provision. Hey, I got news for you, senior citizen, on a fixed income. Rest on the words of the King. Rest on the words of the King. Rest on His words for your provision. God will provide for you. Secondly, rest on His words for strength. Rest on His words for strength. You know, the book of Proverbs says that the Word of God will be, it says it'll be health to your navel and marrow to your bones. Okay? In other words, it's healthy for you to listen to God's Word. It's healthy for you to read God's Word. It's been documented medically. Sometimes people who are in very bad shape physically and the doctors weren't sure what to do or if they could do anything else and the Bible has been brought in on CD or tape and they just play the Scripture over and over to the person who's laying there in a coma. And miraculously, they have begun to get well. You know why? The Word of God is health to your navel and marrow to your bones. It is good. It is good for the inside. It's good for the outside. It's healthy for you to read the Bible. It's healthy for you to hear the Bible. It's healthy for you to rest on the words of the King. It will strengthen you. You can give strength. You can have strength. You can have vigor. You can have energy. Sometimes the people are dragging around and always tired. Everybody, every time you, oh, I'm just tired. Oh, I just go back to bed. Oh, I just don't have any energy. Why don't you get in your Bible? Why don't you begin to get, hey, they we talked about last Sunday night. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. There's strength in the words from the Word of God. You'll be strengthened as you read the Bible. You'll be strengthened as you follow His Word. I want to rely. I want to rest on the words of the King. The strength to serve comes from resting on the words of the King. If you want to get weary in well-doing, get away from your Bible. You want to get critical in your spirit, get away from the Bible. You want to begin to get judgmental of other believers, get away from your Bible. You'll lose the strength, and the arm of flesh will fail you. You dare not trust your own. I'm saying, Sunday school teacher, the strength to keep teaching your Sunday school class comes from relying on the words of the King. I'm saying the strength to rear your children, mom and dad, and continue to love them and have the right mixture of love and discipline in the home and teaching and training is to rest on the words of the King. The strength to be a testimony comes from resting on the words of the King. The ability to witness and to be a testimony for Christ comes from resting on the words of the King. Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Rest on the words of the King. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. So I rest on the Word for provision. I rest on His words for strength. I rest on His words for comfort. How about let not your heart be troubled? You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there ye may be also. Saying, how much comfort has come from those verses? How much comfort has come from the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He restoreth my soul. Hey, how much comfort has come by people resting on the words of God? 1 Peter 5:7, cast all your care upon Him, for He careth for you. How about come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. He's the God of all comfort. Physical problems, sickness, disease, sorrow, loneliness, discouragement, depression. Rest on the words of the King. Rest on the words of the King. There's an old little chorus. I don't know how old it is. He cares for you. He cares for you. He ever loves and cares for you. He'll do what no one else can do. For Jesus cares for you. That's what he's talking about. There'll come a time when you realize no one is going to be able to comfort you like Jesus was. Like His Word will. We remember September 11th, 2002. Not 2001, 2002. Andy was in a bad car accident. He was getting his nutritious breakfast of donuts and chocolate milk. And he had stopped at a gas station and got that, and he had to go, I think, straight across four lanes of traffic to go into where he was going to work. Worked at a medical records office, I think, then. And as you have the two lanes going this direction, of course, two lanes going that other direction, but two lanes coming this direction, there's a traffic light up there, and the curb lane was all backed up. And so somebody stopped and left a gap, and of course Andy is going all the way across, and he's looking to see if any traffic's coming from the other direction, and this guy in the car waves him on out. And when he waved him out, somebody back here got out of that curb lane and got in the left lane and vroom, was roaring up just as Andy was coming out. And he got him right in the driver's side door. And it was really ironic, because I think that was the first day our other son, our youngest son, Nathan, got his driver's license. My wife was teaching school. I was not in town. I had gone with another man down to Alabama. And we had taken an older gentleman who was visiting, taken him back to his house, and then we were going to be driving back. And my wife got her out of school. She's teaching school, and they said, "Your son has been in a traffic accident." Of course, her first thought was, Nathan, his first day driving, probably cracked into somebody, you know. And then we got word it was Andy. And of course, the word we got was he's bleeding out of his ear and his nose, and it doesn't look good. That was the word we got. And so if he has mental issues, no, I'm kidding. But and obviously, what happened, well, a lot of that was glass. He wasn't, by God's grace, he was looking this way, so when the impact come, if he'd have been this way, it would have been a lot worse probably. But that glass had gotten in his ear and such, and they had to get that out. And it, long story short, obviously, the Lord brought him through it. But the reason I tell you that story is here I am now. I've got to drive 7 hours. Well, I wasn't driving. Someone else was driving me. And I don't know what's going on with my son. I don't know if he's dying, if he's living. I don't know if I'll see him alive again. And say, well, what'd you do? As you drive back home in the van and that man drove, you know what I did? I rested on the words of the King. All I did was, that's all I wanted. I don't want to talk to anybody. I just wanted the words of the King. I wanted to find comfort in the Word of God. And that's where you, and my friend, there'll come a time when that's where you'll want to go. That's the only thing that's going to comfort you, is when you rest on the words of the King. Rest on His words for your provision. Rest on His words for your strength. Rest on His words for your comfort. And then rest on His words for your salvation. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Nobody's saved because you felt something. I remember Diane on how many times Jim would say, I gotta feel something, waiting to feel something. I said, Jim, you don't feel, you take the facts first, the feelings will come later. Don't wait on a feeling. You're saved because you place your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior. That saves you. That's what the Bible says. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. And the way you're saved is by resting on the word of the King. The someone you trust, the person you trust is Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans 10 and verse 13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I was just a 6-year-old boy when I called on Jesus and ask Him to be my Savior. And guess what? He saved me. But I don't rely on the experience. Oh, did I feel lighter? Yes. And did I feel like I was walking on air when I walked back to my seat? Yeah, I did. I mean, was the sun a little brighter and the grass a little greener and everything? Yeah, it seemed that way to me. But that isn't why I was saved. And I don't go back and think about that time and say, okay, that's what I'm... No. Hey, salvation is even based on your memory. Don't listen when preachers just say, well, if you can't remember when you were saved, you better get a memory and you do it all over again. No, wait a minute. What happens if you're in an accident and your memory is wiped away and you can't remember anything from the past? Did you lose your salvation? It's not based on your memory. It's based on you resting on the words of the King. See, I know I'm saved this morning, not because I'm a pastor, not because I'm in a Baptist church, not because I'm a member of a church. I'm saved because I'm resting on the words of the King. He said if I called, that He would save me. And so whenever there's a doubt, whenever there's things that arise and you begin to doubt whether you're saved, you've got to go back to God's Word and say, no, Satan. Listen, look right here. If I call on the name of the Lord, I shall be saved. I did my part. God will do His part. And I'm a child of God. Hey, we are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. When you put your faith in Christ Jesus as your Savior, you become a child of God. He puts you in the family. Done deal. Set. It's all settled. It's all done. 2 + 2 = 4. Water runs downhill. And you are on your way to heaven. I go to the words of the King. Rest on His word. Don't rely on religion. Don't rely on a good life. Don't rely on anything you do. Rely on what Christ has done for you. The Bible says that He died for us. We're all sinners. We all are deserving of death in hell. That's why Jesus came, lived a perfect life. And then the Bible says that God commended, He proved His love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He took our place. He hung on the cross, and when He hung on the cross, He took all my sins. All my sins, even sins I haven't committed yet, and He laid those sins on Himself, and He said, God, punish me instead of Stan Slabaugh. And I should have been crucified. I should have suffered and died. I should have hung on the cross in disgrace. But Jesus, God's Son, took my place. And He took your place too. He died for you. And if you'll believe that He died for you, He was buried 3 days later, what happened? God raised Him from the dead. And God says, I'm accepting my Son's payment for the sins of mankind. And God says, that's what each of us must do. We must, by faith, accept Jesus Christ and His payment for our sin as our hope for heaven. And He'll give us the gift of eternal life. And as Romans 10:13 says, you shall be saved. It's as simple as a gift. What do you got to do to get a gift? Just reach out and take it. Say thank you. You realize when you get a gift, the gift of God's eternal life, when you get a gift, someone else has paid for it. Well, if eternal life is God's gift to you and me, somebody else has paid for it. And that somebody else was Jesus Christ. And if you've never called on Jesus and asked Him to be your Savior, I got good news for you. He's here this morning. And He'll hear your prayer. And He'll save you today and give you His gift of eternal life. I'm not telling you rely on the Baptist Church. I'm not telling you rely on my word. I'm asking you to rest on His word. And believe what He says takes you to heaven. Don't believe anybody else. Rest on His word for salvation. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank you, Lord, for everyone's attention today. Lord, thank you for this wonderful example in the Old Testament when your people believed you. And they believed, well, Hezekiah believed what you said, and then they believed the words of the king Hezekiah. And Lord, we have the words of our king, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And you've put them in a book for us. We call it the Bible. And Lord, there's so many times we're so prone to rest on other people's words instead of your words. So often we look in other places to find our provision or to find our strength or to find our comfort instead of looking to your word that's able to provide all of that. God, help us this morning to determine that we will rest on the words of the King. And I pray this morning, God, if any in this room have never rested on your word for salvation and personally put their faith in Jesus Christ as their Savior, that they would place their faith in Him as their Savior this morning. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. I'll finish praying in just a minute. Right now, just between you and God, I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, Pastor, as far as I know my heart, I'm resting on the words of the King for salvation. He said Jesus is the only way to go to heaven, is placing your faith in Him as your Savior. And as far as I know my heart, I've trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I'm resting on His word to take me to heaven. I know that I have eternal life. I know that He has saved me. Here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? Hey, Pastor, I know that I'm saved. Amen. God bless you. You may put it down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know that for sure. I'm not sure if I died, I'd go to heaven. I'm not sure that I've ever truly been saved. But Pastor, would you pray for me? I would just pray for you. I'm not going to embarrass you or call you out, but I will pray for you. Would you slip your hand up and put it back down and say, Pastor, that's me. Pray for me this morning. Is there one like that? I don't think I saw anybody who didn't put their hand up. The message was to believers to rest on the words of the King. And I wonder how many are here this morning saying, "Preacher, the Spirit of God spoke to my heart today. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what the circumstances are. I don't know what troubles are. I don't know what the physical ailments are. I don't know what your situation is. But I know what the answer is. You need to rest on the words of the King." I wonder how many believers here today would say, "Preacher, the Spirit of God spoke to my heart today. Pray for me this morning." Would you slip your hand up? Amen. 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 You may put them down. In a moment I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. God has spoken to your heart this morning. I want you to respond to Him. Just bow the knee before Him. Tell Him you're going to rely on His words in your life. Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts today. And Lord, I'm praying that you'll help each one of us to do what you've bidden us to do in our heart. But Lord, none of us would resist you today, but we'll bow the knee and ask you to help us to rest on the words of the King. Have your way in every heart now during this invitation, and we'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. As he sings the invitation hymn, "God has spoken to your heart." Respond
you
to Him today.
For sweet peace.
That's
and
right.
For faith to increase and have earnestly, fervently prayed. But you cannot have rest or be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul. Would you walk with the Lord in the light of His word and have peace and contentment always? You must do His sweet will to be free from all ill. On the altar your all you must lay. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul. Oh, we never can know what the Lord will bestow of the blessings for which we have prayed, till our body and soul He doth fully control, and our all on the altar is laid. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield Him your body and soul.
Father, we thank you now for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for meeting with us and speaking to our hearts. Thank you, Lord, for decisions that have been made for you today. And Lord, I pray now that you would dismiss us with your blessing. Father, please watch over each of us as we go our separate ways. We do pray for those who've been ill and unable to be in the service today. I pray that you'll strengthen them, Lord, and put your healing touch upon them. Raise them up to be back with us very soon. And Father, we pray that you'll give us all a good afternoon and bring us back this evening for the evening service. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, by the way, this evening, we're also going to have visiting a service, Dr. Martin, who's with Trans Global Health Partners, the kind of the ministry that's partnering with Brother Moreland and 1040, going to give us an update. He's got a special trip planned to a closed country coming up, and you're going to get an update on that tonight, and that's exciting news. So don't miss tonight. It's going to be a great, great time together. All right. Let's sing "I'm So Glad I'm a Part of the Family of God." Brother Bob.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.